kind of getting with it, sure. Lord, I'm coming home.
I want the power.
Today's Father's Day, and ladies are going to do daddy's names. During the Father's Day. Hope all fathers have a wonderful day today. It's good to be a dad. Enjoyment of it and watching kids grow and get weaned away from home and do some things on their own. It's just a good enjoyment. But anyway, all the ladies are going to sing Daddy's Hymn. Week go by, and I hope you all enjoy, because like I said, we've got some talent, and everybody makes an effort to get here, so it's a wonderful deal. Good to see everybody out. Man, we got a little rain. Can you believe it? Here it is, getting the latter part of June, and I thought they forgot about us. And we've got a good rain Friday, and more showers this morning, and more on the way tomorrow night, and Tuesday morning. And if you're in the cattle business, that's good to get a rain this close to July. I'll tell you, because in this country, it may forget about us till about September. So it's just a wonderful feeling to wake up and hear some thunder and clouds and see a little rain dripping around. Good to have everybody here. If you're visiting today, we want you to come back and see us. And church starts at 10 o'clock. When is Sunday school going to start again?
9 o'clock. It starts on the 5th of July.
5th of July, we will start back with Sunday school at 9 o'clock.
So rain and training.
Raining and training, yep. So if you're interested in that, be here at 9 o'clock. And church service starts every Sunday at 10 o'clock, just like this morning. We salute our flag, and I don't think there's a better time in American history that we need to honor our flag and our nation. If you would, stand with me. We'll salute our flag and have a word of prayer, and Pastor Dale will be here. And we might even get back to having a cookie and maybe a cup of coffee one of these days in between, hopefully. My mind's the cookies right now. Good, I salute our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come here this morning, God, and we are so blessed to live in this great nation, Lord. Thank you for the great things that you do for us. Be with our leaders, Lord, and be with the leaders of this church and our pastors today, Lord. May this message touch someone. May this song message touch someone today. God, thank you for our fathers. And again, Lord, just give us all a good day and a joyful day and a good health day, Lord. And thank you for this rain. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Cookies this morning. No cookies this morning. That's
have to go back home and go in the freezer because I wouldn't eat before myself. You know what I mean? I'm so glad you're here this morning, Arrow. And I'm kind of glad for Father's Day myself. My mother was a person like details, and she got me in that habit also, so I copied some things out I thought you would like to hear about this morning, Arrow, before we look into the message. And while I'm reading these things to you, you can take your Bibles and turn to Psalm 101. I'm really grateful for Father's Day. Privileged to be a father of two wonderful children, a daughter that serves the Lord with her wonderful husband, and a son that serves the Lord with his wonderful wife. I praise God that privilege that I had. In the late 1800s, William Smart, who was a Civil War veteran, lost his wife as she was giving birth to their sixth child. He raised his children alone on a farm in eastern Washington State. One daughter, Mrs. John B. Dodd, later realized the extreme self-sacrifice and love her father had given his children. In 1909, Mrs. Dodd proposed a day to honor her father in June. That was the month of her father's birth. That's why that month was picked particularly to do that. And in 1916, President Woodrow Wilson approved the idea of a Father's Day. Nothing set in stone yet, but that was the idea approved. In 1916. The first day announced as Father's Day was following June the 19th, 1910, in Spokane, Washington. In 1924, Calvin Coolidge, then president, supported the idea. But finally, in 1966, President Johnson, Lyndon Johnson, declared the third Sunday of June as Father's Day, and we are in. It was an official thing that's going on in our country about Father's Day. I looked this up too, it's kind of interesting. What celebration in America has the most cards sent out of that time? I've had three cards already today, and I'll feel like I've got a few more cards yet, so I looked that up. And of course, logically, the most cards are usually sent out at Christmas time. 1.5 billion cards are sent in America at Christmas time. Valentine's Day, 151 million cards are sent out from the 1400s, and in England, there's a copy from the first cards ever sent out in the museum they have over in England. Mother's Day comes next, guys. 141 million cards on Mother's Day, and we finally hit the name, number, and there are 93 million cards sent on Father's Day on the average every year. That's quite a bit. Saying we love you very, very much. Easter comes next, Thanksgiving comes next, then we'll St. Pat's Day comes finally. In the matter of these things, 7 million going out at St. Pat's Day. I like silly things too, so I found some silly things. My dad was not saved when I was a child at home. He got saved later in life, and we became quite close friends and so forth. And this doesn't apply to my life, my dad too much, but there is a factor I found out again and again as I talk with people, and especially with kids. And we've got a whole bunch of kids. Aren't there all these kids in here? Good to see these kids here. But here's how kids think. Ready to go? Little boy, no girl, but little boy. 4 years old. My daddy can do anything. 8 years old. Dad doesn't know. Ask mom. 12 years old. Oh, well. Naturally, father doesn't understand. 14 years old. Father, hopelessly old-fashioned. 21 years old. Oh, that man is out of date. What would you expect? 25 years old. He comes up with a good idea now and then. 30 years old. Must find out what dad thinks about it. 35 years old. Have a little patience. Let's get dad's input first. 50 years old. What would dad have thought about that? 60 years old. I wish I could talk over my dad one more time. I like that. I enjoy picking. That's why you enjoy hearing that this morning, hour. So a little more respect to dad this time. You're going to change your mind. You really are in time to come. Psalm 100. Did you get that in the Bible while I was talking? Psalm 100. Now, I'm glad for the fact that the Psalms are in your phones and so forth, and rip out your old phone and just get all this. But what will be a blessing to you really is really carry a Bible with you and a good quality ballpoint pen and learn to mark your Bible. You mark your Bible, it'll mark your life. It really will. And for folks that are saying, well, that's a sacred book. Now, wait a second about that. I was over in Russia preaching, and some of the students in school over there said, Dr. Dale, we don't like marking our Bible. This is the Holy Scripture. I said, no, wait a second, give me your Bible. So I got the Bible. And I said, which part of this is the Bible? Which part of this is the footnotes that some couldn't help them understand the Bible? Well, they understood very quick. I said, this is the Bible, inspired. These are the footnotes printed in it. Well, what's wrong with you putting your footnotes in the same spot? And I never thought about that. You mark your Bible, it'll mark your life, and I guarantee that. It will change your life. Mark your book, do it neatly, and get a quality ballpoint pen, don't mess your Bible. It costs $65, $75 for a good Bible. Don't mess it up. But nothing more than that. I'm going to read the whole 101 Psalm. And I want you to look for something, which I'm not going to take the whole time for this morning hour. And then we're going to look at three things for fathers in Psalm 101. Here are the 10 things. 10 times in this one beautiful psalm, with only 8 verses in it, the words I will, I will, I will are found there. And I trust that every dad here can say this before they leave here this morning hour. I want to read the whole psalm to you, please. I will sing of mercy and justice. To you, O Lord, I will sing praises. I will behave wisely in a perfect way. When will you come to me? I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. I will set nothing wicked before my eyes. I hate the work of those who fall away. They shall not cling to me. A perverse heart shall depart from me. I will not know wickedness. Whoever secretly slanders his neighbor, him I will destroy. The one who has a haughty look and a proud heart, him I will not endure. My eyes shall be on the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. He who walks in a perfect way, he shall serve me. He who works deceit shall not dwell within my house. He who tells lies shall not continue in my presence. Early I will destroy all the wicked of the land, but I may cut off all the evildoers from the city of the Lord. This is David's prayer about his own household, and I trust it's your prayer as well. Let's pray together, and then let's look at God's word this morning hour in three simple, put it all together in those three little points here. We thank you, Father, for the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that the Old Testament is as vital today as it ever was. And these things that David wrote about his household, not always fulfilled in his household, but the dream of his heart, the longing of his heart, because we can't control the heart and the life of the other people. It's our desire, we can't control it. But the dream of his heart, maybe the dream and the longing and the pursuit of our hearts this morning hour, especially the dads, you always hold the dad in high respect. And I pray that the dad will catch the challenge this morning hour and look at Psalm 101. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. I like to call the first part of this, I will live a life of praise. I have a hard time getting that worked out because the psalm starts out by saying, as it does 59 times in the psalms, sing to the Lord, sing to the Lord, sing to the Lord. And I thought if I said it in this church, they'd say, can't sing. Don't know how to do it. But I mean, this church does sing. But Brother Billy said about the praise band up here. It's not just true of the praise band, but the guys in this church sing. I've never watched them do it. The praise band is referred to. All these guys are into a song, they're singing the thing great. But some can't sing. So I changed the word from sing. I will live a life of praise, and particularly for three things. Number one, I will live a life of praise because the mercy of God, which is in his first verse here, endures forever. And I like being a dad because we are older than those over here, And we know that God's mercy has been there all along. And the thought it was all over, he was there. And the mercy of God was there in that particular situation. In Psalm 108, verse 4, God says that his mercy is great. And in Hosea, there's a question raised. What does God want of us men? And the very first thing he answers back with is this: to love mercy. God wants that of us, to have mercy in our lives. Did you guess the song the girl sang? His hands could be hard as steel, but they always are covered in love. They always kind of love those hands, your daddy's hands like that. Or the right kind of a dad. Some dads aren't that way, but that's what God wants of us, for he's full of praise at all times for the mercy of God that God gives to us. And this is so strong in Romans 9 and in the book of Matthew 9. And Romans 9, both, they both say, God wants mercy. What is mercy? Holding back from us punishment we rightly deserve because of love. And God does that to us. For not for the mercy of God, everybody here, Preacher Dale, down the line, we'd all be in hell. But God, in his mercy, sent the Savior to die for us from the cross of Calvary. And because of that mercy, that's what we have. And we can sing that, praise the Lord, because of the mercy of God. And I thank God for that. So God wants a man whose life is filled with praise for the mercy of God that has come to us. And then the other word in verse 1 is this, and there's justice. And how do we get justice? Well, it's an amazing thing because none of us deserve it. Everybody here again, man, woman, whoever, we are all guilty. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. God said that, not me. All of us have come short of the glory of God. Is that how close you were, how far away you were? I can still recall times when I had two particular times when I was out on a trail ride to a horse someplace, basically breaking a colt someplace, and you do the round pin work, you step on the colt's back a few weeks later on, to take it outside the pin, not into the woods, not on the trails, out through the pasture land like that, to ride the colt. And I walked home because the colt would decide he had enough of me out there. And I can recall very clearly one particular day, when this colt began to buck, I grabbed for the horn and went, shoo, right across the top. If I had 2 more inches, I'd have rode that baby home. If I didn't have those 2 inches, I was gone. And I walked home. And that happens sometimes. And that's us. We are almost, we think, there. We're good, better than some, but God says you're short of the glory of God, and you're going to walk home. And no heaven for you, unless you're born again by the Spirit of God in your heart. So God, being a just God, sent a penalty for our sin called Jesus Christ, who died on the cross of Calvary, and he paid penalty for our sin. He's the justifier, and he's the one that did the justifying of all people. He made it possible to be saved, and he did it by himself, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross of Calvary. And I thank God for that. And then, I like the fact he tells us here, I will sing praises. Go back in your, if you have your Bible in front of you, go back to Psalm 100, just right above that in my Bible here. And it says this, make a joyful, and this is the New King James, shout to the Lord. The old King James puts it this way, make a joyful noise to the Lord. And I like that, so I called it this. We want to live a life of praise for his mercy, for his justice, and then because of himself, to God alone. Remember anything else thinks about the thing like that? What does God think about your heart's expression of your joy with him? Make it joyful, shout to the Lord. Can't carry a tune, don't worry about it. I sing a lot when riding a horse, they don't understand the words anyhow. They have no idea what I'm singing about. So just enjoy yourself and shout to the Lord. Have to get in the bathroom, turn the shower on, how you're all tired like that, turn it off. But praise the Lord. He delights and he dwells in the praise of his people. That's in the book. And God wants us to praise him at all times. I live a life of praise. Number 2. Look at verse 2 in chapter 101. Psalm 101. I will behave wisely in a perfect way. For when we come to me. Can y'all hear okay? Is that rainbow? You're okay? Good. I could shout, but I won't do that. Maybe I will do that. I will live a life of purpose. For when you come to me, he longs here, for the fellowship of God, that God might be close to him, he might be close to them. Keep in mind that when Jesus Christ chose 12 apostles, whom we think of as preachers, as teachers, as ambassadors, he never chose them for that purpose, first of all. He chose 12 men that they might be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach. The most important part was that he might be with him. Every dad and every wife knows this. You can do an awful lot holding hands, not saying a word. Holding hands, not teaching anything to do. Just, you're there, you say, I love you. Here's my hand to prove it to you. You've all found out very close. Reach across the davenport, across the steering wheel, and just says, I'm here and I'm with you. Just be with him, and then to preach the word of God. But the first part is this. Are you with him? How much time do you spend just being with him? That's so vital in the things of God here. I want to be paid wisely in a perfect way. I want to be in fellowship with God. Amos said years ago, can two walk together except to be agreed? Learn to be in fellowship. Learn to know the word. Learn to say, I was wrong. I'm sorry. Get back into fellowship again. For the wife, a husband that God gave you. That's the first thing I see about this thing here. And then I found this out also. I went to 1 John 2:6. Not bad. You still with me? Okay, good. I like this. I like the rain. Let it come, buddy. We can all shout the rain. I was in a church one time where a little kid got screaming and hollering, and the mother got all frustrated. I said, I can all shout him. So the girl said, don't worry about the mom yet. 1 John 2:6. Now watch this very carefully. He that says, he abides in him, ought himself also so to walk, even as he walked. Three parts. Number one, the expression of my lips, he that says. Number two, this thing here, the expectation of my life, ought himself so to walk. Number three, the example of my Lord, even as he walked. If I say that, I ought to live like this. When I had my first class this morning about baptism coming up, I made it very, very clear that the purpose of baptism is to show people we die to the old life, we are buried in baptism, we are obliged to walk in a new life. That life is gone, this life begins. And God is saying here, if you save under Christ, let me see it. Paul told Titus this, the book of Titus, he says, show your faith, show your belief. Don't talk about it, show it. They'll catch on pretty quick when they see the change in your heart and in your life. So you have the expression of your lips, the expectation of your life, and the example of the Lord. Where do you start this thing? He says here, in my house. In my house. Why there? He carries that over in Acts chapter 1. Where do you begin to witness for Jesus Christ? We're on a street corner someplace, on a soapbox. We're out behind a pulpit someplace in a church. No. You begin at Jerusalem, then you go to Judea, then you go to Samaria, then you go to the uttermost part of the earth. Why here? Because starting at home is the hardest place in the world to witness. They all know you. They all know you. What are you going to see the change in your life? That's what your wife wants to see. That's what the kids want to see. They all know you. Here, you start here in Jerusalem. You start here, David said, in your house. Because they all know you back there. And that's pretty true. That's pretty true. So if you're going to be a perfect person with purpose in life, you're going to start with God in your house. That's our first mission field. That they might want Christ, you've got to see Christ in you. And that's very vital in a family life and so forth. I laugh at this because even going to church here for the last few weeks with masks on. Them on in the church. You're in the church and you take the mask off. Maybe you have to think about that in your life. What kind of mask are you wearing at home? Take it off. Take it off. And that's what God wants to see in our hearts and in our lives. Take the mask off. Number three, you want to live a life of purity. And this got to my heart because of the book of Job, believe it or not. Look what he says about purity here. In verse 3, I will set nothing wicked before my eyes. I don't know about you people, but I find that purity very strongly depends on where your eyes are. And for men in particular, the eyes are a dangerous, dangerous thing. For example, one day at the ranch, I was taking a trip out of people. I was in front, mother right behind me, right behind the picture, not make sure that everything's going okay like that. And we got off of a dirt road, where a macadam road crossed the dirt road. And so I went on the macadam road to block it while the fire arrived and across the road, that in front of them again, to keep the turbine going. So I turned to go to get my spot to take it apart. My eyes passed in the ditch about the road, a big ditch there. And in that ditch was a Playboy magazine opened up, full center picture. And my eyes caught that thing, bam, just like that. That wasn't too bad. But the thing about it is this, as a man, I could not get that picture out of my mind for years. And I thought the word used today is called pornography. One of the greatest habits, almost impossible to break, is when a man or a woman is caught in pornography. And I made a list of some things like this. My eye, Job said this, I made a covenant with my eyes, I would not look on a woman. As far as things of lust are concerned, you know, Job chapter 31 and verse 1. But I thought of these words here. Contemporary illustrations. TV. Quote, art, unquote. Magazines. Posters. Advertisements. Look, it's filled with it. You can't sell a thing anymore without selling sex to them somehow. And it will damn your life. You're going to believe that. Watch your eyes. In the book of Malachi, God talks about the things he hates in life. The most things he hates is a broken family. Malachi says twice, guard your spirit. Watch what your eyes see, how you react with your eyes. And guard your spirit. Or just damn your whole family if you don't do this particular thing. So he gives you a lot of purity and he starts with your eyes up here. God wants that cared for. You know, then avoid evil. He says here, I hate the work of all those who fall away. What they're doing, I don't want that in my heart and mind here. And so you're going to live a life of purity. And then the last thing he says here is that sinners will not be endured in my family. What's the purpose of that? If you're my family, they stop. When they visit, they'll stop. They live here, they'll shut up. They're not, they'll live in my family, in my house. That's the man. Those three things about him in Psalm 101 about fatherhood. Maybe you ought to ask three questions about God. Number one, who are your friends? Who are your friends? Number two, who are your heroes? Who are your heroes? And number three, who are your guests? Who are your guests? And your wife will ask, and your girl will ask, who does daddy look at the most? That's a big question. It's a life-changing, life-storytelling question. Who does daddy look at the most? Or maybe what does daddy look at the most? But David in Psalm 101 says, here's my heart's cry and plea as a father in this family. Did it work out? Not exactly. He had kids that were guilty of rape, guilty of murder, guilty of trying to take the throne off of him. He had a hard life. But there was sin in his life also. But this was his heart's desire. And David died as a friend of the Most High God, living for him, bringing his will in his heart and in his life. We want dads like that at Calvary Church to live like this. Psalm 101, take it. And may it be a joy to you. I put these things down to close with. This is a day for number one, reject evil. You see it? Get rid of it. Take it to the cross. Die to it. Die to it daily. that's gone in your life. Number two, renew your covenant with your wife. Remember what you said that day you got married? When you told her she was the only love of your life? Renew your covenant with your wife. Go back to that. And number three, you dedicate your heart and your house to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. It'll change your life. May God do that for you on this Father's Day. I would be pleased to pray that. Father, thank you for Psalm 101. I'm bad in a way that it was David the Buddha, because David did have some bad times, heartache, sorrow, tears, because he messed up. But thank you, God, he had a tender heart and kept coming back to you and kept seeking to do your will in his life. Give us men with a hunger for you, men with a desire for holiness, a desire for purity, and may they have purpose, God. May they praise you, and may our church change because our men change to do the work and the will of God. This I ask in Jesus' name, for his glory alone. Amen. Happy Father's Day. God bless you all. We'll get cookies here pretty soon.